video is brought to you by Knowledge at the Australian School of Business.
Many people would like to be as ecologically sustainable as possible, and yet they're still going to jump into a car every day, they're still going to leave lights on in the house, which probably isn't insulated, and they'll leave the heating running. That all burns up fossil fuels, which causes CO2 into the atmosphere. Now, there are ways of reducing CO2 in the atmosphere, but a fundamental flaw in people's logic in their thinking seems to be impeding action on global warming. This cognitive limitation, which seems to impact even on very bright people, has been researched by Professor John Sterman from MIT. He's a Michael J. Crouch visiting professor at the Australian School of Business, and he's with me now. So what is a fundamental issue that people don't get?
Well, climate change is just about the most difficult challenge that we face. You have incredibly long time delays between when we change the energy system we use and the impact on the climate. You've got nonlinearities that create the possibility of tipping points. And on top of it all, it's a common pool resource problem. It doesn't matter to the climate where the CO2 comes from, so each nation wants other nations to cut their emissions first. This makes it a very difficult problem, much more difficult than, say, reducing local air pollution from cars or industry, which itself has proved to be very difficult. So we've been studying why people have difficulty understanding the dynamics of the climate and what can be done about it. So, as an example, we've discovered that many people believe that if we begin to slow the growth of carbon dioxide emissions and eventually stabilize those emissions, so we stop growing the rate at which CO2 is being added to the atmosphere, that would stabilize the climate. And this is just not true. It's not true as a matter of basic physics. Here's the way to think about it. The amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is a stock. It's an accumulation. It's like the amount of money in your bank account, or it's like the amount of water in a bathtub. And everybody knows that if you pour water into your bathtub faster than it drains out, well, Julian, what's going to happen to the level of water in the tub?
Oh, of course, it'll overflow.
It's going to rise until it overflows, of course. Everybody understands that. But when it comes to the climate, if you ask people, what would it take in order to stabilize the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, they say, all you have to do is stop the growth. And in our experiments, 84% of all the participants violated conservation of mass. That is, they told us that you could continuously pour water into that bathtub faster than it drains out, and yet the amount of water in the tub would still magically stay constant.
Okay, so how can you educate people? How can you get them to understand the concept?
So what's going on is not that people aren't smart. It's that we're using the wrong frame to think about this issue. When you ask people this kind of a question, what they're doing is using what we would call the correlation heuristic. That is, they think that the output of the system should look like, be correlated with, should look like, have the same pattern as the input. So if we stop the growth of emissions, the climate should stabilize. Now, correlational reasoning is extremely effective in lots of situations, right? If you eat this plant and you get sick, you eat that plant, you get sick, pretty soon you're going to learn not to eat that plant. The correlation there is extremely useful to you. And therefore, we've evolved with the capability to detect correlations and then use them to make decisions. We haven't evolved with the ability to reason very well about stocks and flows or this process of accumulation. The good news is people can learn how to think about bathtub dynamics and to recognize the existence of those bathtubs in the world, whether it's the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, amount of money in your bank account, the number of alternative vehicles on the highways. People can learn to recognize those accumulations and to think correctly about how the flows affect them. But it's not something that comes automatically, so it requires some mindfulness.
For many people, they're looking at how long climate change may actually take before it's a reality, before it directly impacts on them, and they're going, I'm going to be dead by that point. Why should I care?
Yeah, so I think this is a common belief, but I think it's it's missing two important aspects. The first is the climate is already changing. We've already warmed the planet by about 0.8 degrees C on average, but that already leads to impacts including rising sea level, including more extreme weather events, floods in places, droughts and wildfires and others, and we've seen that here in Australia. And so the climate is already changing. But the more important issue is whether people truly don't care about the future. So you can try this with yourself, with your family, with people that you know and you meet. Whatever age they are, ask them if they have or plan to have kids. A lot of the people that I interact with are students or executives, 25 to 55 years old. Many of them have children, some are planning to have children. Let's say somebody is going to have a child this year. Well, in the developed world, life expectancy at birth is about 80 years. And your grandchild can expect to live well past the year 2100. Are you really saying you don't care about that? Most people, they care. I don't think it's this attitude that après moi le déluge. I don't think that's the problem. I think people are overwhelmed by the complexity. They're overwhelmed by the long time delays and by the helplessness that they feel in the face of the scope of the changes in our society that need to take place. And when you're presented with consequences that are potentially catastrophic and simultaneously with the feeling that there's nothing you can do about it, that's a very difficult feeling to sustain. And so faced with that cognitive dissonance, what we tend to do is just say the problem's really not that bad. We might get lucky, or outright denial that there's even anything to worry about. The interesting thing is our society has addressed challenges in the past that are as daunting as this. And just to give you one example, starting in the late 1700s, a small group of people began to agitate to abolish the slave trade and slavery. Nobody thought this was possible. And you heard the same kind of arguments that you hear today about the climate. People stood up and said, if we do this, it'll destroy our economy. One slave trader at the time said, slavery is the hinge upon which all the trade of the world revolves. Well, it's a long story, but it's basically a story of a few people having the courage to stand up and say, this is wrong and we must end it. And we're talking about people like Thomas Clarkson and John Newton, who penned the famous hymn Amazing Grace, and William Wilberforce and a few others, and they gradually recruited more people to their cause. Within 50 years of Clarkson's initial conversion to this idea, the slave trade in England had been abolished. That's a rather short time to do away with an institution that had existed essentially as long as there had been civilization. We're just talking about finding a different way to get around in our cars and heat our houses, how to have hot showers and cold beer. In some ways, this has got to be a lot easier than dealing with the abolition of the slave trade. So I'm personally optimistic. What's needed and the bottleneck to action is understanding better how people form and change their opinions about complex matters and providing them with tools through which they can learn for themselves. It's never going to work for me to tell you how you should think. I have two kids when they were teenagers. I learned this lesson the hard way, as most people do. You can't tell those people anything. You've got to learn it for yourself. So most of the time we learn through experimentation and experience. But in the case of climate change, you can't do that because by the time we experience the harm, it's too late to do anything. So we have to create simulations, micro worlds, or management flight simulators. Think of them as video games if you like, but grounded in the science, absolutely consistent with the science, through which people without technical training can experiment, try any policy they want. What if Australia is carbon tax is kept in place? What if it's strengthened? What if China does this? What if the United States does that? What would it take collectively for the world to cut our carbon emissions and lower those risks? That's what we've done, and the simulation tools that we've developed are being used by the UN, by the climate negotiators for the United States. There's a version of the model in China, in Chinese. We need to get that out more to the general public, which we're working on. It's available for free online. People should go to climateinteractive.org, and you'll find everything you need there to get the models and play with them yourself. So I think that's the way in which we're going to begin to make progress on this very tough issue.
Well, I'm sure the debate about the carbon tax continues to rage in Australia. Many people will be doing that. John Sterman, it's been great talking to you. Thank you.
For more business news and analysis from Knowledge at the Australian School of Business, please visit knowledge.asb.unsw.edu.au.